Now, I'm just, as I say, going to save this. So I'm going to save this as I'm working on A Midsummer Night's Dream, you'll appreciate. So I'm going to put this in here. And I'm working in this space here on my Creative Cloud space. So I'm going to call this, I've already done it once, as you can see, but I'm going to say Dream Cover 20 V1. And I'm saving it as an InDesign document. Okay, so now that I've saved that, I can now begin the process of working on this. Now, obviously, there are two elements to your work. One is the text and one is imagery or anything like that. So, you know, how you actually deal with it depends, of course, on the topic or the play. The play itself is the thing that you need to, you know, understand a bit about so that you can at least begin to build up the images for the cover. So, I mean, in certain ways, what I tend to do is to think about the text first of all. And I just wanted to go through some of that with you because it's very important when you're working with text. In this particular case, you want to make sure that you use the text creatively. So rather than just, in my case, writing, as I might do, you know, let's say I just draw a text box here and then just write A Midsummer Night's Dream. Now, obviously, that's a beginning of our work. But on the other hand, you are going to need that separated out. You are going to want to make use of all of those words in a more creative way. So you really want to take those words and split them. So the way that I would do this is maybe start with the idea of thinking about what font I want to use for this. So a number of different ways. I've actually got my workspace arranged so that over here on the right hand side I've got my properties panel and I can bring up the font that I want to use. Now obviously we can come back in here and change this at any point, but I'm just going to look for what I'm actually looking for is a block serif of some sort, maybe. So maybe I'll use this. And then I want to increase the font size, obviously. Now, as you can see, you can step through the font size or you can just simply write in the font size. So if you write in here in this box rather than just increment it, then you can make that decision for yourself. So I'm going to call this 100 point. Maybe that's a little bit too much. Let's go to 80. Okay, now you'll notice over here that in this part here, this is actually the leading. And if it has a bracket around it, it means that you've got an automatic leading. So your leading is automatic. That's something you can let InDesign do. However, you can control that yourself. So for example, if I want to make sure that I've got less than the automatic, so and obviously if I go, I can't at the moment reach my 80, so I have to type that in. So if I want to say give this a leading of say 85 point, something like that, then it's obviously going to bring it together. And at the moment obviously this is still too big, so I'm going to reduce this down now to something like that. I'm just looking for something for approximately for the main words in the text. So let's work with that. Now the other thing I'm going to do is to turn off hyphenation so that we don't hyphenate it. And then what I'm going to do is to use the complete space here for the moment so that I can reorganize my text. So okay, so having that now, those words set out like that, what I'm going to do now is just to take that and actually give myself three copies of it, or maybe even more. I'm going to need 1, 2, 3, 4 copies of it. So what I can do is just take that and copy it. So copy it and paste it again. Okay, now for this one, I'm going to take out everything except Midsummer. Okay, and then I'm going to copy this again. And I'm going to take everything out except Nights. Okay, let's just put that to one side. I'm going to copy this again. And I'm going to take out everything except dream. We'll worry about the letter A later. Although actually we can just take it out of there, can't we? Okay. Let's put that over there. Put this here. And now we've got these three words that we can make use of quite independently. Now, obviously, I know some of you might be thinking, oh, well, I can't do that. I'm using Hamlet, so I can't really do anything like this. But it's important that you think about these things as discrete entities so that you can then move them around rather than as you do when you're just writing text. Okay, so these some of these things are obviously a little bit too big, so that's fine. I'm going to now take this this text and actually reduce it down a little bit. So let's take that down to there. And fit this into here. Obviously you can get the idea. You just want me to, it's very difficult to do these things in a live presentation, but I just want to make use of these words separately. And I'm now going to think about how I want to make use of these in terms of the font and so forth. So first of all, let's think about Midsummer. Well, I want to make that a different font. So I'm going to pick a different font from my list. Now, you can probably see here that I've got filters set on. So if I look at my filters, I've actually got a block. I've got my block slab, or my sorry, slab serif as a filter. So I'm going to clear that and now think about something else. So maybe for this one, I'm going to use a script. Maybe use Apple Chancery, maybe. And that didn't like that for some reason. I don't know why I did that. I quite like Philippa. That looks quite interesting. Maybe not. Anyway, you can see that I don't really want to do a live choice of various fonts and so forth in this presentation because, you know, you're going to think this is absolutely awful, which it is at the moment. But the point is that you want to try to separate these things out. So what I'm going to do is to now, at the other side of the pause, I'll just show you what I've actually done to bring these various elements together using different fonts. So let's just leave it at that. See you at the other side of the pause. So after choosing fonts and playing around with the individual words, then I've come up with this this basic idea. So I need to obviously still think about whereabouts these various components are going, and as you can see, I need to move it into an appropriate position within the front of the cover. But essentially, what I've done is I've said, well, okay, I don't want to just have them all the same, so I'm going to give myself the ability to move these things around separately and choose different fonts. Obviously, I can also now think about taking different colours here as well. And in fact, you can see with the word knights, I've actually used, you can see the font that I've used here is something called Zapfino. And Zapfino has quite a lot of flourishes. As you can see, the G and the H are kind of very elaborate. And I could possibly even get those to overlap. So this could overlap the word Midsummer. But of course, at the moment, it wouldn't make a lot of sense since they're both black. But maybe by changing the colours, that I could actually do something with that. So the way that we change the colour is if we select the word itself within the text box, and then over here you'll see you have this fill box. Now obviously at the moment we've got certain colors within the within the template existing already, but you can add colors to this. So if you click on new swatch, you then have a copy of the one that you've selected. You then just double tap this, and then you can actually make a different color from your swatches this way. You can either do it through this controller here, or you can even choose a Pantone color. Now, we're going to be talking about how we print this. Generally speaking, the cover is likely to be printed CMYK, or in other words, the process colors. But you might be thinking about printing it in spot colors. So depending on really what you've got, if I've got a sort of like a more painterly photographic type image in the background of this cover, then obviously the whole thing is going to be printed in CMYK. So it doesn't really make a lot of sense to choose a Pantone color at this stage. So I'm going to stick with, sorry, I didn't mean to get rid of that. So I'm going to try and create a color here from my swatches. So from my, my blender here. So I'm going to choose a, yeah, a sort of reddish color like this. And then I'm just simply going to click OK on that. OK, that's the word night. And then midsummer, maybe for midsummer, I'm going to use a greeny color. So again, you can choose that here. You might already have an existing color, or you basically create a new swatch to go with it. Now, you can see here that I probably need to name it. I can name this my, you know, midsummer green, if you like, and then I can change this color to whatever I want, whatever shade of color I want. Now, to a certain extent, I'm maybe getting a little bit too carried away here, because it's going to all depend on whether I put an image in the background of this, and I might well indeed be doing that. But you can see the general idea that once you start to have the ability to manipulate the individual words, you can make some kind of you know, good relationship between them, and give yourself a unified a title. Now, the other thing is, I mean, I'm obviously going to carry on doing this work, but one of the things that you might want to do at some stage when you've made that decision is then take all of those text boxes, and I can do that by using my shift key and click each one in turn. That's one way of doing it. Or I can just get my mouse and drag a box around all of those objects. And then what we do, because we've now grouped them together, we've got them together, collected together, we then go to Object and Group. That means it's now become one unit which we can move around. So as you can see, if I want to then decide whereabouts it's going to go on the actual front of the cover, then I've got that as one unit that helps me organize the content. Okay, so that's basically what I'm going to do with the text, but now I need to think about what I'm going to do for the rest of the cover. Maybe I could obviously include just a background color. I've gone to put the William Shakespeare name on it as well in a moment, but let's actually see how we progress from here. Okay, so you can now see that I've added the words William Shakespeare, because obviously we want that on the front of the book as well. But I wanted to just just explore some things with you about how you might want to, again, give yourself a little bit more creativity with just within that text. I mean, obviously I've chosen a particular font. This is Allegraia. Now, the important thing about choosing the font, one important thing, is that when you choose your font, or should say the typeface that you're going to use, have a look to see that it has quite a range within the family. Now, this particular font, Allegraia, if I go over here, you can actually see I'm using regular at the moment. But if I click on that little down arrow, you can see this actually has quite a few different weights. So it's got bold, black, and italic, and so on. And so that's actually quite useful, so that I can actually make use of those different weights. So what I'm going to do is to highlight the word Shakespeare, and rather than just the regular form, use a bold form. And that just gives me a little bit more, interest in that, in just even the way that I display the word, the words William Shakespeare. Now, the other thing is that you'll notice that this is in a frame, in a text box. And I'm going to, in a moment, I'm going to put an image on the background here. That will be my next job. But that we might want to move that around somehow and put it in the right position. But we'll see how that goes when it comes to putting a background image in now. So that's the next thing that I'm going to do. And in order to do that, I need to search around for an image. Now, maybe this is something that you've already done. But we actually need to gather our assets together in terms of the way that we want to use this. Maybe you've actually already pulled together a few images to give you some scope for organizing your cover. So I'm going to go right over now and take a look at a very useful source, which is where you might actually find an image that you can use in the cover. So let me again see you the other side of this pause. Right, so you can see that I've come to the Folger Picture Library, which is a huge resource material. This is actually the URL for it, although I've posted a link on Moodle for that. This is just one place that you might be able to find images to use on the cover or indeed on the internal pages of the book. We're obviously going to search now for our play. So I'm now searching for A Midsummer Night's Dream, which is already in that because I've done it once before. Okay, so I'm going to click on the search button. And that's going to come up with a number of images, quite a lot of images actually. So this is something that might take you a little bit of time because if we scroll down to the bottom, you'll see that we've actually got 2,739. So that's quite a lot. But I'm just going to go through and I'll find something pretty quickly, I think, which I'm just going to show you how we can make use of it. So here's something here, for example. So this is an engraving. And I'm going to pick that up here and just investigate that. Now, I might want to make use of this, just part of it in the cover. So I'm just thinking about how I might want to make use of that. But as I say, this is just me doing an online presentation. And, you know, we might want to spend a lot more time on this in actual fact. So let's actually think about taking this. Now, the important thing is, how do you get an image from the Folger Picture Library? Well, you'll see up here that you've got this little export button. So you click on that little export button, and then you'll see that you've actually got a number of different sizes. Well, you really want to get the biggest possible image that you can, because although you know, these images are only going to be in 72 dpi, that's actually too low for print. But because it's so large, we can actually make use of it in InDesign, shrink it down, and then you'll find that we have the possibility of making it into a higher resolution. So let's actually do that now. So it's exporting. It's going to take a little bit of time, as you can see. And that's now going over to my downloads folder. So I'm going to pick it up from there. And in fact, this particular image, I think it's worth us having a look at it in Photoshop. So it's a JPEG image. It's 11 megabytes. So I'm going to just drag that onto my Photoshop icon just to have a look at it, just to see if there's anything that I might want to, you know, to crop out. Although actually, as I say, we don't necessarily need to do too much work on it in Photoshop because we can always modify it within InDesign. So I brought it onto the screen now. So this is the image. And as you can see, it's a landscape image. So, you know, really entirely what you want to do when you look around to see what your image is and how you're going to make use of them. But this type of image here, I might want to use in some form. But what I'm going to do actually is just to leave it as it is. And then I'm going to place it into InDesign. And then we can still manipulate it, as you will see. So let's go into InDesign now. And now I'm going to place this image in. So you'll find place or Command D if you want to use a shortcut. And then I'm going to my downloads folder. Actually, that's really probably what I shouldn't do. I should actually locate it and put it into my assets on my, it's somewhere available to me. But I'm just going to do this now quickly. Bring this in here. I don't want to replace anything that I've selected. And I'm just going to, what I'm going to do is just to drag it across here, even though, as I say, I'm going to want to probably only use a portion of it. Okay, so that's my image, and you can see behind here how I've actually got the red mark here. So what I actually want to do is I want to make sure that I've got that some part of that image going right the way to the red. So if we want to make the image a different size, it's very, very important that you use the Shift and Command key together to drag that corner box, and then it will keep it in the same proportion. Otherwise, you're going to end up with something that's distorted. So do be careful about that. So I'm going to now drag this image over to the right, because what I want to see is I just want to make use of a part of the image which is around about that size there, so that, as you can see, it's actually going right to the red, the image itself. So now what I can do is to crop the image down to the red like this. I don't want to use it on the back, so I want to take it right the way to the front like this, and then up to the red, and then over on the right hand side, take it right the way to the red. Now, as you can see, I've still got the possibility of moving the image around a little bit, but not too much. But if I drag the little circle in the middle, you'll see that I can move it one way or the other. So if I wanted to, say, just bring the image a bit more to the left like that, then I can do that. So the image, what you have to remember is the image, in a way, is two parts. There's the actual box in which the image sits, and you've got the ability to move the image around within the box. Now, obviously, what's happened right now is that we've covered the text over, because this is sitting on the top. And so what we can do is we can click on that. We've got that image selected. So if we go now to Object and go to Arrange, we can send it to the back. Okay, so now we've got the text sitting on the top, and so we can begin to think about how we might want to make the text more visible, because obviously at the moment it's virtually impossible to read it. So we have to then make some decisions about how we're going to use this text over this image. I mean, this is just one example of how we might want to use an image and text combined. But you'll see, I'm going to obviously spend a bit of time now coming. I'm going to pause now and go back to my image folder and have a look around at some other images and see how I might want to make use of them in combination with the text. Because at the moment, this one isn't necessarily working for me, because I don't have the ability to make the text very visible. I could do it, because what I would need to do is to actually just make the text more contrast. So for example, the word midsummer, if I actually made that white, then it might possibly work. So you can see already, you know, that might be a possibility, but you need to, you know, you need to sort of work on these components of the text in relation to the cover itself. So you might, for example, want to bring all of this which is a group and move it around so that it actually sits over the top of the image in a more appropriate way. So if you want to make use of this image, for example, then move the text around until you find a suitable location for it. So let's say we'll do this. So we'll actually make this that color, and we'll actually use the word dream, make that also white, or paper color as it should be. Okay, and you'll see that there's a certain amount of transparency on the text, which was actually deliberate in my case, but I can actually change that to be more of a solid color. For example, if we take this here and actually make it much more opaque. Right, yes, the opacity of the box is slightly less than 100%. Same with all of these, actually. So I think even the word midsummer has also got a little bit of transparency on the box. Okay, so you can see that you know that I can continue to play around with this. But one thing that I just wanted to give you the heads up on, the important thing, is that although we've got this image in here now in InDesign. You can still work on it in Photoshop if you want to manipulate it, change colors and so forth. And we do that by simply right-clicking on the image itself and then go to Edit With and look for Photoshop. There's the image. Now, if I want to make some changes to it, like, for example, if I want to change the color, this at the moment is RGB. That's absolutely fine. I can change it to CMYK in a moment. But what I can do is to give it a different color balance. So let's say, for example, I want to make it more of a yellowish tint. Yellow green tint, maybe, like that. Then I can do that. And then if I just simply save it, not save as, don't change the name of it, just simply save it like that. And then if we go back to InDesign, you'll find that has automatically changed like that. Okay, now other things that you might want to do, well, of course, if you want to make the image itself, push it back, if you like, in the overall effect, so you don't want it to be so strong. But before I do that, let me actually do something about this color here, because this probably should be in our white or even possibly a yellow, maybe. Let's see what that does. Yeah, that's more interesting. Okay, so if we now want to knock the image itself back, now we can do that in Photoshop. We can actually reduce the contrast or something like that. But one of the other things that you can possibly do is to create a box. So we simply create a box here to lay over the top of this. Okay, and then fill that with a color. So let's say we use a dark blue as a possibility, or possibly a lighter color, sorry, something like that. And then with that, we then make that transparent. And you'll see we need to reorganize it in terms of its space. But I'm going to just do something like that. Now, what we now can make use of are the layers in InDesign. Because if we go to the layers panel, and by the way, if you can't see it by the little icon, you'll see it over here, window and layers. So just tick on that and it will appear. And you'll see in the layers, we've actually got these various components. The image itself that I've just, or the color box that I've just laid over the top here, that's actually sitting right at the top. You can see that I've actually, because I've selected it, it's got a little blue square there. That means that I've selected it. And now what I want to do is to bring that down below the text. Okay, so it's below the text, but it's above the image. And that's what we've got there, okay? But we can still, having got it selected, we can still do things like, you know, change the transparency of it and so on. So if we look at the, just send that away and go back to this. So with that fill, that particular color, we can change the color, but we can also change the opacity. So we might want to not knock it down quite so much, but you can see this is actually happening live now by me adjusting that opacity. So we might want to take it down, you know, something like that. Just an idea, really. As I say, you know, lots of things we can do, lots of different things we can do. Now, the other thing is William Shakespeare. Let's actually look at that now. Now, William Shakespeare, the word William Shakespeare isn't really strong enough. We could make that text white. But another option that you've got with the text over the top of images is we can actually make it stand out in another way. And the way that we can do that is to actually give the text box itself a color. So I'm going to fill the text that text box with black. Now, of course, as soon as I do that, it means that the text itself, and that's by the way also slightly transparent, but the text itself has now disappeared. So what we need to do now is to select the text and make that white, or paper color, as it's described. Okay, now that's sort of okay, but what we need to do when we have text in a text box like this, and we need to sort of work out how we can make it centered in that text box, or if you like, make sure that it has some some padding inside it so that the words aren't, you know, distributed unevenly, which they are at the moment with the William sort of crashing up against the edge of the text. This is left-aligned text, so it's going right up against the edge. Select that text box, go into Object and go into Text Frame Options, and you'll see in here we can actually have spacing around it, like this. So we can actually say we want the spacing to be 1 millimeter or however many you want. So I'm actually just going to adjust it by 1 millimeter, like that. I can, of course, make it aligned to the right or to the left. But what I'm going to do actually is to use that, but then what I'm going to do is to drag it all the way, the text box, right the way to the red line. So it goes right out to the edge, like this. So we've got a box that word is sitting in, and you might want to consider how you align it with the text itself. And you can see if I drag the box, it actually shows a very faint green line, which is saying, oh, you know, that is going to line up with the edge of the word midsummer, which might be good to do, because making sure that everything is aligned in this way gives it a much clearer and balanced look. So that's the front of my cover then. So I'm going to leave it at that for the moment, and we'll enjoy working on the back of the cover a little bit later.